O deputado provincial Rudy Casero, do Partido Conservador, eleito por Mississauga Lakeshore, promoveu recentemente uma conferência virtual para ouvir empresários luso-canadianos sobre o orçamento de Ontário para 2021. Veja como foi.
Ouvir as necessidades e sugestões dos empresários luso-canadianos para a elaboração do Orçamento Provincial de Ontário. Foi o objetivo de uma conferência virtual promovida pelo deputado provincial Rudy Conceito, da área de Mississauga Lakeshore. O deputado abriu o encontro explicando os objetivos da consulta.
I'm looking forward to hearing directly from you on what we should do in the 2021 budget. Your feedback received will be shared directly with the Minister of Finance.
A primeira empresária a fazer a pergunta foi Filomena Silveira, que atua como contabilista na comunidade luso-canadiana.
I deal with a lot of clients and my concern is more with the smaller clients, the ones that could not function properly last year, but they continue having a lot of difficulties this year, and also some that basically start a business at the beginning of 2020. They don't really have that comparison with 2019, and they really not be able to take advantage of the grants and the benefits that's been given to other businesses that are actually active. And what I found is the ones that are being active are taking more advantage of this situation than really the ones that, the very small ones that really cannot function. So I'm just really wondering if it's anything in the budget to help these clients, especially the ones that started in 2020 and don't have the comparison to 19, and also the ones that really cannot function properly because they deal with settings that it's impossible to run their business, and they still have to pay rent, they have to pay still certain overheads to stay above the, you know, to continue their business.
Leo Pereira, dono de uma empresa de seguros, foi o segundo a participar da consulta.
My business, it's been in operation because we are essential business, so we haven't stopped at all. Been very hard for my staff. We have to work with closed doors and with all precautions, but anyway, we are still going, and it's important. As far as budget and small business, what my point of view is, the government has two options: either helps the small business, or the bill or the payroll goes up on unemployment, which I think is a terrible idea. I think is the smartest idea to really support the business and maintain people at work. This way, you know, the government grants or guarantees revenue and diminish its social costs. Besides that, also it's very important to keep the morale. People are, right now, we know that we, all of us, are having trouble in maintaining this situation, being locked down, and it's complicated, very difficult.
O casal de empresários do setor de entretenimento, John e Elisa Santos, também fizeram sugestões.
Just a thing to keep in mind when you are discussing budget, you are discussing things and what things are happening. Not everybody lives in the same box.
And then the other thing we do is live shows, ticket sales, which obviously we can't do. Magazine selling advertisement, which of course everybody is suffering, so nobody wants to spend money in advertising. That goes for television, newspapers, our magazine, etc., etc.
Yeah, so that was the point then, that we do run by virtue of sponsorship and advertising, and sponsorship of course is advertising, so we have lost a lot of money. Okay, but we are, in order to keep our business alive, we are keeping our business alive. We're still working for significantly less. But one thing that John and I have realized, that in being in a business which is relying on sponsorship and advertising, we are going to sort of be at the end of the line when in terms of recovery, because in order for us to run, we are basically running with companies that have an excess revenue to allow them to participate in advertising. And I think that a lot of the companies that are going to be, number one, they're doing it now. And even as they start to improve, they're going to be holding on to what they've got. They probably have a $40,000 loan to pay back to the federal government. So we're going to be at the end of the line in terms of seeing this recovery. So we just want people just to keep those sort of things in mind, that there are people that many other people in our situation or in their own particular situation who do not live in the world that most people do, which is a January to December year. And we're a backline. We get money from people who are successful.
O diretor do Correio da Manhã Canadá foi o único representante dos mídias portugueses a participar da consulta e expressou preocupações com a comunicação comunitária.
It's very hard to keep the business life because, you know, especially now, we don't sell nothing. What we do, it's advertising. And if we don't have a support from advertising people, our business, they cannot go. If I don't have advertising, I cannot survive. And two people here helped me, like Lee is one, Michael Yetch for the beginning, and Filomena Silveira is. If I don't have that kind of people like them, so nothing to sell. It's just something to get it from my people. I lost a lot of clients because he cannot continue to support me in advertising. For example, restaurants, supermarkets, car dealers, he sell the car, but he got also the excuse to say, okay, we cannot do it because of the pandemic. That it can happen. So what I can see, like Lisa said, and Firmen and Leo, in this budget, I think the government, you should look for us, for the small business, because we are small, but we have employees. And if I cannot keep going, my employee is going to go to implement. It's going to do more damage to the government.
Também participou da consulta o empresário Mike Pereira, do setor de transportes rodoviários.
My business went down by 40 to 60%, depending on the month, with roadside assistance. And I find that the wage subsidy is great. That helps a lot, but for the employer, but the CERB kind of hurts us. I can't find workers. People are saying there's no jobs, but I can't fill my trucks. I have 30% of my trucks parked. So I'd like to see a bit of more of a balance, harder for people to get the CERB without trying to get the work if the work is there. You know, with our trucks, we don't allow customers in the trucks. So the drivers do not interact with people face to face. They do social distancing, all that. So it's a safe job in terms of the Corona stuff, right? But like I said, at the beginning, I lost probably 70% of my drivers. I'm up to probably, I lost 70, I'm probably up to about 70% of them back. But this whole year has been pulling teeth to get the trucks on the road. The work is there. A lot of it has come back, but I can't do the work because I can't get the drivers. So that would be helpful if there was some kind of better balance between the wage subsidy for the employer and the CERB.
A empresária Liz Calouro, da área da construção civil, trouxe as preocupações de um dos principais setores económicos da atuação da comunidade luso-canadiana.
The other issue is there is, you know, immigration. There's the provincial nominee program. It's got to be opened up a bit more. We have so many people in this country who are, you know, like, and I've got guys on work permits. I've got about 4 or 5 of them on work permits. And I've got one right now that he can't qualify under immigration because his English, written English, is horrible. He's an excellent worker, you know, and he's young. He's 35 years old. He's brought his family here. We need people like that. And we've got to really look at this provincial nominee program and push it because obviously we can't do federal, so we've got to push it. And the government, especially in the construction industry, we all know that there's tons of underground economy. We need people on work permits. We need those people on work permits to be forced to work on with deductions, so that they're contributing to society and get rid of the underground.
E por fim, Suzy Stutt, cuja empresa fornece café e chás para restaurantes, cafetarias e empresas, fez as considerações do setor para o orçamento provincial.
This budget needs to come with a structured approach to reopening. The hardest part for our businesses is to invest in the PPE, the proper social distancing practices, the proper sanitation practices and cleanliness practices, and not be able to open. Even on a modified scale, even on a modified capability, they're not able to open. And when the dates kind of skate by with regards to the numbers aren't looking good, we have to stay closed. Or this is the date that we're going to open, but now we're closed again. They're not given that capability to earn. And that's very, very upsetting, obviously from a human perspective, but from a financial perspective as well. Because if they're not earning, they're not contributing, and they're not investing right back into the province. So if we don't provide them with a structured reopening date and hold fast to those dates, the funds that the government needs to actually substantiate this budget won't be there.
Todas as questões discutidas, de acordo com o deputado provincial Rudy Caceto, vão ajudar na elaboração do orçamento, de acordo com as necessidades encontradas em consultas virtuais do género. O orçamento da província de Ontário deve ser apresentado e votado no Queen's Park, em data ainda a ser definida, nos próximos dois meses.